Welcome, guys. I'm Dr. Mike Hansen. Recently, on Saturday, June 12th, 2021, Christian Eriksen, a 29-year-old from Denmark, suddenly collapsed during a soccer match as a result of his heart going into sudden cardiac arrest. His heart wasn't able to pump blood to his brain, he lost consciousness, and he fell to the ground. Within minutes, the medical staff surround him, they check a pulse, there's no pulse, so they start CPR, and he gets one shock to his chest to defibrillate his heart. Fortunately, they were able to successfully resuscitate him, and he's doing well now. By the time you're watching this, he's probably already had an extensive cardiac workup, including blood work measuring troponin levels, EKGs, an ultrasound of his heart, meaning an echocardiogram, and a cardiac MRI. Christian Eriksen is far from the only young athlete to have a sudden cardiac arrest while playing a sport. Reggie Lewis with the Boston Celtics, Hank Gathers with Loyola. Between 2004 to 2007, soccer players Mark Vivian Foe, Miklos Feher, and Antonio Puerta died of sudden cardiac arrest, which led to FIFA enforcing players to be screened before competitions at all levels. Thankfully, Francis Muamba survived in 2012. Sudden cardiac death is defined as unexpected death due to a previously unknown heart condition, and it occurs within 1 hour of symptom onset. The incidence of SCD, or sudden cardiac death, among young athletes is overall pretty low, around 1 in every 75,000 young athletes per year. Normally, a healthy heart is in a sinus rhythm. Chances are, if you're watching this, you're in a sinus rhythm, which means if you check your pulse, there's a consistent rhythm to it. How does this happen? The beginning of the electrical signal in the heart originates in the sinus node, which is located in the right atrium. Think of the sinus node as the drummer of a band. Sure, he might be a little crazy, but it's the drummer's job to keep the timing smooth and steady, to keep a consistent pace of the song. For example, let's say the song is at a tempo of 100 beats per minute. The rest of the band is in sync with that drummer at that tempo of 100 beats per minute. The last thing you want is the guitarist to be soloing at a tempo of 130 beats per minute and the frontman singing at 170 and so on, because that leads to nothing but noise and not music. And that's essentially what happens with the heart right before someone has a sudden cardiac arrest. This is called ventricular fibrillation, aka VFib, which in essence, the ventricles of the heart are not pumping blood to the body because the electrical circuit is going haywire, completely out of sync. They're doing nothing more than quivering. In that moment, if the heart is not defibrillated, meaning shocked with a jolt of electricity, the heart will soon be in even more trouble, something called asystole. In other words, zero electrical activity in the heart. The chances of reviving someone at this point becomes even slimmer. So when someone has a sudden cardiac arrest, another rhythm called ventricular tachycardia sometimes precedes the VFib. This is when the origin of the electrical activity is in the ventricles instead of the sinus node, which is in the atria. Persistent VTAC often deteriorates into VFib, and that's why VTAC needs emergent medical attention. And this is why AEDs are so important. An AED is an automated external defibrillator. You turn it on, you put the pads on the chest, it senses if it should shock the patient, and if it's appropriate, it's going to deliver a shock in an attempt to reset the heart. So AEDs and sideline medical teams with specialized training in CPR are required at every professional soccer stadium in the world. Had Christian Eriksen not had CPR with an AED put on his chest within minutes, his chances of survival would have been extremely small. After one defibrillation, his heart went back into sinus rhythm. Thankfully, not only did he survive, but he didn't even require a breathing tube to be put down his throat, which is usually the case when someone has a cardiac arrest. Because when the heart stops, the cessation of breathing soon follows. So why would an athlete, who by all means is in superb physical conditioning and of extraordinary health, all of a sudden have their heart stop? Although it rarely happens, there are lots of different causes of sudden cardiac arrest in a young athlete. Often, sudden cardiac arrest, or SCA, is the sentinel event of an underlying previously undiagnosed heart condition when a person is put through rigorous physical activity. As someone who works in the intensive care unit, I've had several young patients who experienced sudden cardiac arrest while exercising. When it comes to different types of heart disease, you can think of them falling into one of four broad categories. One, is there a structural problem with the heart muscle, meaning the myocardium? Two, is there a structural problem with the arteries that feed blood to the heart, meaning the coronary arteries? Three, is there a structural problem with the valves of the heart, whose job it is to prevent blood flowing backwards? And the fourth category, is there a problem with the electrical conduction system of the heart? So with that in mind, let's get to the top seven most common causes of sudden cardiac arrest in young athletes, starting with the least common. So number seven, drugs. Although it didn't occur while playing a sport, the most famous case of cocaine causing a young athlete's heart to stop was Len Bias. Bias was incredibly talented, selected by my favorite NBA team, the Boston Celtics, with the number two pick in the 1986 draft. Less than 2 days later, he died as a result of cocaine intoxication at just 22 years old. Now, there have been other case reports describing SCD, or sudden cardiac death, in young athletes who had previously no known heart disease, but were taking androgens for performance enhancement, and they were found to have enlarged hearts at autopsy. I personally had a patient that this happened to. Now, you can imagine how difficult it was for me to break the news to his mom that her son was clinically brain dead. So drugs, including steroids, just not worth it. Number six, electrical disturbances of the heart. So there are several different arrhythmia syndromes that some people are born with, and the heart is usually structurally normal in these cases. Essentially, the electrical wiring of the heart is a little off. Examples would include long QT syndrome, short QT syndrome, Brugada syndrome, early repolarization syndrome, and catecholaminergic polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. These can usually be diagnosed with an EKG, and I'll get to talking about screening athletes with EKGs at the end of this video. But these patients are especially sensitive to electrolyte imbalances, specifically low blood levels of either potassium, magnesium, and calcium, but also low pH levels of the blood, meaning acidosis. So when people are participating in vigorous activity, not only do they have the potential to become dehydrated with electrolyte imbalances, but the vigorous physical activity can cause lactic acidosis, which is one type of acidosis. Now, there's another type of acidosis called ketoacidosis, which occurs with either starvation ketoacidosis, but also the keto diet. Also, those with an underlying heart condition, especially when it comes to their electrical system, are more susceptible to caffeine and energy drinks. So that's another thing to keep in mind. Number five is myocardial infarction, aka a heart attack. So myocardial infarction, or MI, which is when a part of the heart muscle dies off as a result of not getting enough blood flow. And this occurs when a coronary artery becomes blocked. It's a very uncommon cause of sudden cardiac arrest before the age of 35, but it does become more prevalent with age. So Jim Fix was the author of the New York Times bestselling book, The Complete Book of Running. Not only did he popularize running, he was considered the face of America's fitness revolution. He advocated that regardless of diet or genetic susceptibility, an individual would not suffer a fatal heart attack if they were a non-smoker and exercised sufficiently. So although there's a lot of truth in that, especially when it comes to exercise and not smoking, the rest wasn't really accurate because genetics and diet play an important role. Fix had a family history of premature myocardial infarctions. In 1984, Fix was age 52, and he would run 10 miles a day. On his final run, he had an SCA from a large heart attack. Autopsy reports showed major blockages in all three major coronary arteries. Daryl Kyle, at 33, was a pitcher for the St. Louis Cardinals. And in June of 2002, he was missing from pregame warmups and later found dead on his hotel bed. Autopsy revealed the cause of death to be myocardial infarction, and he was found to have a 90% occlusion in two of his three coronary arteries. Number four, myocarditis, which is inflammation of the myocardium, meaning the heart muscle. Lots of different causes. Most commonly, it's caused by various viral infections, including COVID, but sometimes it's caused by an autoimmune condition like giant cell myocarditis. Sometimes there's no known specific cause. So Hank Gathers had SCD while playing an NBA game. Autopsy reports revealed that he had idiopathic cardiomyopathy with residual interstitial myocarditis. Idiopathic means no known cause, and cardiomyopathy means disease of the heart muscle. So what about COVID disease or COVID vaccination? there are reports of COVID and the COVID vaccine causing myocarditis in young athletes. But it's been reported that Christian Eriksen did not have COVID and did not have the vaccine. Okay, number three is ARVD. At age 22, Antonio Puerta had routine health checkups 3 weeks leading up to a match, and everything checked out okay. But in the game, he suffered a SCD, and the autopsy report revealed that the cause of death was arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. So ARVD, it's a rare form of cardiomyopathy in which the heart muscle of the right ventricle, and sometimes with the left ventricle as well, is replaced by fat and or fibrous scar tissue. The right ventricle becomes dilated and does a poor job of pumping blood to the lungs to pick up oxygen, which ultimately leads to the left ventricle not pumping as much blood to the rest of the body. As if that's not bad enough, the RV, the right ventricle, becomes more prone to developing deadly arrhythmias like VT and VFib. Although the cause is not known, it tends to run in families, and it's best diagnosed with a cardiac MRI. Number two, anomalous origin of a coronary artery. So Pistol Pete Maravich, who played for LSU, was named the greatest college basketball player of all time by ESPN back in 2005. He's the record holder for college basketball's all-time leading scorer with 3,667 points. In 1988, he suffered a sudden cardiac arrest at a promotional game and died at age 40. Autopsy report revealed the absence of a left coronary artery and scarring of his heart tissue that was a result of chronic decreased blood flow to his heart. All right, last but not least, number one is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. HCM is one of the most common causes of sudden cardiac arrest in young athletes. This was the case with Miklos Feher, Reggie Lewis, and Mark Vivian Foe, who played in two World Cups and was playing for Cameroon in 2003 when he had a sudden SCA. So autopsy results revealed HCM with resultant VTAC, ventricular tachycardia, as the likely cause of death. HCM is a type of structural heart disease. So just like you can have hypertrophy or enlargement of your muscles from working out, this can also happen with the heart muscle, which doesn't happen from working out. This type of muscle enlargement of the heart, it's not a good thing because the muscle, it starts to get in its own way and less blood is able to be pumped out of the left ventricle. So an echocardiogram can usually make this diagnosis, but sometimes a cardiac MRI is required. So what about the new Apple Watch 6? Apple claims that they can have EKG monitoring right on your wrist. Would this be helpful? Maybe. One issue is its accuracy. It's certainly not as accurate as a 12-lead EKG, but how accurate is it? Only time and high-quality studies will tell. But even if it's accurate, would it be useful? Maybe. One problem is that for young people who suffer from a sudden cardiac arrest, things are cruising along just fine for them in sinus rhythm. But then boom, all of a sudden they go into VTAC or VFib, and EKG monitoring at that point is useless, unless you have an AICD in your chest, which can then shock the rhythm, meaning cardiovert, back into a sinus rhythm. But there may be some instances where it could actually be useful. For example, sometimes people can have premature ventricular contractions that can be a tip-off to VTAC. Or maybe they have non-sustained VTAC, meaning the VTAC is very short-lived, and that could prompt someone to seek medical attention. Or maybe the monitoring can detect a prolonged QT, or a short QT, or ST elevations, or ST depressions, etc., that could prompt someone to seek medical attention before it's too late. This is something I'm interested in to learn more about in the near future, and we'll have more to come on this matter. Can sudden cardiac arrest be prevented or screened for in the first place? Most athletes have health screenings, including a history and physical exam. There are a lot of similarities in the screening process between Europe and the United States, but one of the big differences is that Europe includes doing a 12-lead EKG. Whether or not to screen every athlete with an EKG is a matter of debate between cardiologists. A more aggressive screening process entails a less evidence-based approach and a higher financial cost on the health system. Regardless, cases like this highlight the importance of having AEDs and their availability, not just at sporting events, but gyms and public places in general. And since fast action is the key determinant to survival in those who have SCA, it would also make sense to have athletes trained in CPR, especially in instances when medical staff is not immediately available. So that's all for this video. And if you like these types of videos, do subscribe and hit that bell notification. And I'll see you in the next one.